I'd already introduced Mrs. Manju before. She's the principal at GIIS. And now, she'll be talking about the true facilitator is not a slave of technology, but a maverick magician.
Good afternoon. I just requested the lovely lady sitting in front to help me out. I'll come to you with that once again. Technology conference, and my topic says slave of technology or a maverick magician. And especially after a heavy lunch, I guess I have a big task on my hand to keep you all awake. I'm certainly not against technology. The only thing that I wanted to talk about today, especially when I got this call to pick a topic, and I didn't want to take up anyone on the list, was to bring the focus back to the learning. And that's where my story begins when I say, when you look at technology, are we looking at becoming a slave of it, or are we still respecting the maverick magician that's a facilitator in a class? So when you have a technology-laden classroom, my question is, who tells the story? And that's where the focus needs to come back to. And in a smart classroom that we often talk about, the focus shifts from the magician to the smartness of the classroom, which often gets restricted to a smart board, a laptop, or so many other technology devices and platforms that we talk about. A very big red flag for all educators to think about, because if we don't make our classrooms smart, and in the real sense smart, by making our facilitators realize that it is the magic that they can weave around with the technology, I think we'll still push our classroom back to the 14th century. So who tells the story is a question that we need to constantly ask our facilitators to bring the focus back onto what we want to derive out of the technology. Just try to look at images and a visual understanding of, if you were to talk about, how does a smart classroom look like? And if you take a random survey, everybody's going to talk about how the smart one looks like. Probably a couple of laptops, there would be a smart board, you might have clickers with which you can do an MCQ. It's a long list of technology that is available. And ideally, in our country, even today, you have majority of the classrooms which look like that. So how do you bridge the gap? First question. Second, do we want to bridge the gap? And do we want to bridge the gap only with technology? That's a question. I'm still a teacher at heart, and I hope I never let that go. So I still like asking more questions than giving an answer. And having said that, I come back to the first slide where I talked about Robert Frost when he says, darkness does not hide. The darkness does not destroy what it conceals. And that's a thought that I still want to hold on to when we talk about technology in a classroom. There's much more that we don't know exist. And that is what we need to probably chase. Going forward, do we want to bring the digital transformation into the education? Definitely. There's no doubt about it. As we talked in the morning also, it's not a choice anymore. You have to bring the digital transformation into the technology. But again, I raise my red flags very often when I say, what we want to leverage out of it, what is the platform that we are looking out for, and what is the learning that we want to derive out of it, is a very important question. And in a platform like this, where there are decision makers and principals and people who impact an entire education institution, that's a focus we should never lose, is what I feel. We're just looking around Pinterest and all, and we found this image of almost 70 best apps available for teachers, and there are thousands more. There's no dearth of it, right? So there are schools who would just go randomly pick up anything that comes on board, and to later realize that it's not working for my class. Technology is required in a class, but for every classroom, for every learner, and for every facilitator, it's not a one size that fits all. So we really need to ask it, what are we doing with the technology? It may be assessment, it may be learning platforms, it may be things like Peer Deck and Smile where you share content, but what am I achieving out of it is the most important aspect. For decision makers and principals, we often fall into the rut of it because we look at the wow element of it. What is the outcome that we're looking at it, and what is it that we can project out of it? That may sail us through the first 6 months, probably a year, At the end of the day, if the learning doesn't take place, and if it doesn't leverage or it doesn't make learning for the student real, it is definitely going to fall flat. We've seen so many examples of educational technology which has been there and vanished into thin air in a couple of years. We don't want to do that. So that's a question that we need to ask whenever we look at a technology platform coming to us, that what am I looking out of it? Interesting man. I'm not showing the TED talk here, but Sugata Mitra proved it years ago that with a simple computer put out in Delhi in a slum with a high-speed internet, you could make learning absolutely real. And he tried out his experiment, not just in India, abroad also, and he kept saying that I'm trying to prove myself wrong by looking at the data. And he could get children who had never any exposure to the English language or to the technology which was made available to them through the high-speed internet. They were able to learn something as complex as DNA structures and atoms and molecules and, you know, astrophysics, merely by engaging with technology. And there is an absence of teacher over there. There's no facilitator there. Yet they were able to do that, right? If we take that as one end of the spectrum, now imagine the other end of the spectrum are classrooms where there is a facilitator and we have the choice of the technology to bring that into the classroom. So the right choice of technology with a magician in the classroom can literally transform the class. And that's the only way that we're going to transform our nation. Because it's no longer a choice about, do I want to use technology? Is it going to give me more leverage in terms of talking to the parents? It's like the classic case of what happened in Delhi a couple of years ago when you had the pollution and severe situations where people couldn't step out and breathe. And it was said by a lot of social networks saying that the rich could buy the air purifiers and they could get on with it, because it were the rich who were having those industries which was polluting and the water being polluted. But none of the air purifiers worked. At the end of the day, it was the three small, simple plants like a money plant and the mother-in-law's tongue and the acacia palm which helped clean the air. But the fact of the matter is, it's an equalizer. So if we today restrict our decision making to very narrow ends, it's gonna boomerang back on us. And each of the decision maker here would cry hours about the fact that you don't get the right kind of teachers anymore. And that's a product of a technology lacking education system which was there 20 years ago. So if you're looking at sustaining our education industry and doing the right thing, even if you're very selfishly looking at that, I want my institution to get brilliant teachers 20 years down the lane, let's change our focus. That's most important. So what are the key elements of technology that we look at? I'll not run through it very, I mean, most of you know that. It does not discriminate. Technology does not discriminate against anybody when you're using it in a classroom. It helps in the development of cognitive, affective, and psychomotor skills. It can humanize a lot of dehumanizing factors which you find in classrooms very often. It's a brilliant tool at that. Of course, it helps new learning. It's data-driven. That's a new fad in the education, but what we do with the data is also a question that we need to ask, right? And of course, it helps critical thinking. So this, the last point is what I would just take a fraction of a second to bring everybody's attention to. We often say that technology can help in critical thinking. But when technology replaces the facilitator, you absolutely move away thinking. Forget about critical thinking. If you replace a facilitator allowing a class to move ahead with a video and a discussion and probably a few more manipulatives that you want to help, then you encourage critical thinking. But if you just play something, give them something to work with, or even gaming for that matter can be beautifully, you know, engraved into a brilliant class, provided the facilitator knows that what am I deriving out of that gaming session in the classroom. I gave this to the lovely ladies here and I asked them to quickly do it. If you could just tell me the average time that you took to get the minion home. Barely a second. Brilliant, they're in the right place. Did any of you try doing something like this? You did? I'm extremely impressed, right? This is what we want our children to be able to do, even if they're in grade 10. So move away. We've been talking about the fact that they should be able to do a wrong answer too, and be sure that I thought different, and that's a track that I can follow. And that's exactly. Absolutely. this is a danger that we are talking about. This entire generation is completely divorced from the beautiful art of reading, and hence the imagination. I was talking to somebody out there about the fact that the 3D printing and the maverick spaces that we are talking about has been created by a generation which did not have it with them. It's been created and made available to us today by a generation which did not see it, but had the imagination to look at it. Think that what are the infinite possibilities that is there for us to check out a line, a path, a problem that exists and how to solve that. Today, when we choose the technology, let's also encourage our children not to jump straight to the outcome, but put them through the critical thinking. And that's most required. And technology can do that. It's often coming with a big red flag saying that it's an addiction, children are with the screen time more, and they don't have an imagination. But there is enough that can be done to ensure that imagination can be churned out of these children merely with the right use of technology. I just turned JFK around. It says, ask not what technology can do for you, ask what you can do with the technology. A very important question that can be always kept at the tip of our tongue for all of us as decision makers and people who are at the helm of affairs to decide. Whenever a technology comes to us as a choice to be used in a classroom, we must ask that, what is it that I can do with it? What is it that I can derive with it? And what is it that my student in a classroom is going to take out of it? And always, I probably the mornings round also, I came out probably as somebody who's against assessment. I'm not. But what is it that with technology, when we use technology for assessment, what exactly besides the data and the analytics that comes out of it, what can you use it for? The humanizing aspect is what we're looking at over here. The big critical questions I want to leave you with: what is a smart in a smart classroom? A fundamental question we all need to always ask, right? And in our quest to upskill the learners, do we ever lose them? The focus always has to be on the learner, and we should never ever focus, ever lose that focus from them. So when you upskill their skill sets, when you look for using technology to make it much more interesting for them, make the learning much more realistic for them, never let your radar and the focus move away from the learner. So keep that focus there. And what's the role of the magician? So especially this comes in when we take in a technology platform for a classroom and we have those typical training sessions. A typical training session would be more about the technicality of the technology. And unfortunately, it gets restricted there in most cases. Even if, when we have follow-up sessions, being a generation which was not there with technology, most of our facilitators still are very wary of technology being used in class. Be it the simple thing that I need to feed in marks to using technology as a learning tool, it's still that, you know, I'm not very sure, I'm not very good with it. As somebody spoke in the morning, and all of us know, you give a mobile phone into the hand of a one-year-old and a one-and-a-half-year-old. In 15 minutes, they know which button to press to see the video that they want to see. And they're very good with it, right? So, but our generation is not so sure about it. We're still scared of technology. I remember telling my mother when I bought her a new mobile phone, I asked her to just fiddle with and play around with it. And she was so wary, I had to tell her, it's not a bomb, it's not going to explode. You know, just click a couple of buttons. Worst case scenario, it'll just shut down. We'll start it again. But that's a generation, including our generation, which is going to say, no, I want to have a manual. I want to read through it to understand what it is. And unfortunately, children are the only thing that come to the world without a manual. Right? And we're dealing with them day in and day out. I leave you with it. Technology is a useful servant, but a dangerous master. So what's the influence that we are thinking about? Who should be the final influence in a classroom? And how that magician can use technology is a question that we all should be thinking about in a classroom, as decision makers, as people who impact education for generations to come. Thank you so much.